Joining me today is Wayne Walton. Wayne is an entrepreneur and the founder of Mountain Hours, a community-based alternative currency. Much of his activism takes place in his native Summit County, Colorado, where he's currently working towards restoring human sovereignty through monetary reform. Wayne, thank you for being with me today.
I appreciate being on.
Starting off, maybe you can tell us a bit about your background and how you got involved in monetary reform and local currencies.
Well, really, my why I do this is because I'm angry. And the reason I'm angry is because I bought into the whole glory of, the United States. And when I was, I come from a three-generation military family. My grandfather fought in World War II. My mother and my father both met and married when they both volunteered for the Korean War. My brother's retired Navy, and I joined the Marines when I was young. And I always remember going back, way back, and there was a movie called Boys in Toyland or something like that with Laurel and Hardy in it. And they had these toy soldiers that there was like this mean guy that kind of ran these demons through this town. You know, this is a movie from the 30s or the 40s. I'm almost 50 now. Anyway, they were ravaging the town, and they had these little, it was March of the Wooden Soldiers that went through the town, and they saved this town. So I always had this real kind of like a hero quest. So my hero quest was to be in the military, and I grew up studying history and military tactics and playing chess and strategy and studying the motivation for different wars, particularly the Civil War and World War II, and I would sit with for hours watching this TV series called World at War, which my father, and just really enjoyed the history surrounding that. So I bought into this whole hero and military thing, and that's what I thought my society wanted from me, et cetera, et cetera. And I kind of just wanted to go to war, just to blow things up, and I was just kind of destructive because it just looked neat on TV and in the movies. And this TV movie, It's a Wonderful Life, the hero there was when the brother came in, and he's, George Bailey saved him, and he protected the ship, this transport, and all these stories wrapped around the military hero guy. Well, all of that changed in 2008 when I was studying, the bank bailout was occurring into the fall of 2008, and I was studying FDR's Gold Confiscation Act, and found out that all of the gold was getting turned over to the private for-profit Federal Reserve. Well, why possibly would gold be collected from the people and get turned over to this private entity, which was a shock to me that the Fed was private. I just found that out. And you have this government official ordering people to turn gold over to this private entity. Well, at that time I was a pool contractor for some 20 years, and I knew that that was a bankruptcy. Well, that means the bank is the sovereign of the United States. The bankers are in control. And I realized then that the whole thing was theater, that these elections are theater because the bankers are in control, that bankruptcy has never gone away. And then it got even worse when I found out that the bankers were financing each side of these various different wars, and they started the wars off with false flags. And that pissed me off. So I dedicated my soul that I was going to remove these evil creatures from power, and started on a quest as to figure out what is the correct monetary solution so that we wouldn't have to use theirs. That initially started off with gold and silver because I was listening to a lot of Alex Jones stuff at the time and was a supporter of a Ron Paul. Then I came to realize by listening to George White Harris Berry, who explained that even prior to the Fed, the bankers controlled gold and silver, and they still ran the show then. And then I was a supporter of, greenbacks or public banking. Then I studied that some more, and basically Lincoln perpetrated a genocide war and a military draft while we had public banking or greenbacks. And the British Empire was formed while the tally stick was the dominant currency. So that centralized currency isn't a solution either. You don't want to have a monopoly either on gold or silver, or a government monopoly. Monopolies, whether public or private, aren't a good solution. And any of those systems would require a vote in order to implement. So that brought me around to investigating Paul Glover's currency, which I just bumped into. And, you know, that's what makes me so mad is never, ever did I ever, you know, I used to listen to Alex Jones religiously. I never heard anything about barter script currency in the form, you know, there are 3,000 local currencies in the United States during the Great Depression. When Argentina had its economic collapse in around 2000, they used barter script in order to save people from starvation. Barter script is what happens when currency, when the bankers make their money scarce in order to have a currency collapse, in order to gain assets and seize land and cause chaos. Barter script is what keeps people from starving. It's what occurs organically and naturally. So that's what got me interested in this, because it's something that we can implement without a majority or without permission from the corrupt. So therefore, it's something that we can control. It's not something that we need to be dependent on either governments or banks.
So going off that, I guess the obvious question is, what are mountain hours? How are they issued? And how do they compare to other forms of centralized usury-based fiat currency presently being issued by centralized banking authorities around the world?
Well, right now, all the money is issued by a private entity called the Fed. That's the global system. There's already a global currency called Federal Reserve Notes. It's private, and all that money's loaned as a debt with interest, and the interest makes that debt unpayable. That occurs even if that money was loaned locally with gold. That same thing would happen even at 1%. That's why all the profits forbid usury, which is money monopoly and interest. So money monopoly and interest are forbidden by all the great prophets and even the great philosophers. So that's the first thing that's different, is that rather than centralized authorities issuing the currency as a debt with interest on a monopoly basis, our money permits any producer at all to issue money just in the exact same way that a restaurant owner issues a gift certificate. Money's just a contract or an IOU, and it's not a commodity. So what makes our money the better solution is that it's denominated in time. Time is the only commodity which the have-nots have control over, and time of an hour is a fixed unit value that exists naturally in the human consciousness, just like a month or a year or a day. It's a natural astronomical solution. It's a quantity that's fixed by the universe. So hours are something that are fixed in time, and we can use this currency without inflation, without deflation, and then there's no fraud. So that's why it's superior to absolutely any currency out there, superior to any currency. And it comes in a initially paper form. And the way we circulate it is when a local business effectively just raise their hand and say they want to participate in our barter network. We give them 20 hours, which is 20 hours. I shouldn't say that we give it to them. We give them pieces of paper, which the business owner then signs into circulation, and we do that purposely so that we demonstrate that the business owner human being, not a computer like Bitcoin, not a government like greenbacks, not a bank, a human being issues this currency into circulation locally, so it returns power to the people naturally, organically, from the bottom up. And since it all has a common unit value of an hour, that unit of currency can be spent anywhere on the planet, and we don't have to have currency exchange fees. So this is a common unit of value that we can spend anywhere in the world, that everybody knows what it is, and it just sets up a global barter network without usurpation, without centralization. It's not a solution. It's the absolute best solution.
So the value itself is derived from people's signatures, and it avoids debt issues because it doesn't have usury attached to it. And also your system prevents inflation. Is that all correct?
Yeah, because an hour is always 60 minutes. And, you know, people go, well, how does that work? Right now we have an hour, we make it equivalent to 10 Federal Reserve notes, but we don't need to keep it that way. We just make it that way in order for, let's say, a local t-shirt shop or a dispensary, for instance. Let's say I like using things to challenge people's minds in a dispensary. If they sell, let's say, a quarter ounce of marijuana for $50 or something, that would be 5 hours. So people need to be able to know what the conversion is so that they know, you know, how many hours to sell their products with. However, all the other monetary systems, all the other units, they refer back to hours. So if somebody's working and getting paid for their time, you know, you work for $10 an hour. With our system, you work for 1 hour per hour, and that's what an unskilled laborer would make. And that's if you're mowing a grass or raking leaves, or here in Breckenridge, you shovel a lot of snow, you would make an hour per hour. Skilled and semi-skilled or highly skilled, they would make quantities of that. So if a doctor got paid $160 an hour, they would make 16 hours per hour. And, you know, naturally there'll be some people that are more productive than others, as is the case with any, you know, you're always working with human beings, so there's always going to be different productivity levels. However, this is the optimal way in order to have a base unit to build a future on, to build a platform on. In the same way that, you know, if we're going to build a house, if we had 20 different units, that there's one guy who's doing the framing and he's using inches, and then there's another guy in the other room who's using meters, you know, you're going to end up with complications when you have the blueprint. It just complicates things. Whereas if you have a common unit value where you're going to build this new future on, and there's no interest, because that makes it sustainable. Our debts will always be able to be paid. Whereas in the dominant system, whether it's gold, silver, or Federal Reserve notes, whenever you have a system that's based upon interest, that makes the debts become unpayable. It's impossible to pay exponentially growing debt with linearly growing productivity. Nor do we need to. It's completely unnecessary, even if you wanted to for some dumb reason. In our monetary system, we can have a mortgage of 30 years paid off in 10 years because you eliminate the interest. So, you know, why would anybody in their right mind possibly want to pay a 30-year mortgage when they can have a 10-year mortgage for the same payment? It's just profoundly revolutionary, this idea. And all it's really lacking is people to accept it. And, you know, we need some better software than we have right now. But on a fundamental basis, it's not difficult to create databases and software in order to have this revolution. It's not like we have to create a system to fly to the moon and build all of those systems where it would be very technically challenging. It's relatively easy to get people together and build databases and a software system to build this. Some of it already exists, but it just needs to be perfected so that it works. And a good way to think of it is in a local community, just imagine you had 10 people in a local farmer's market. Let's say there's 10 tables and, you know, I make wheat and you make bread and another guy does t-shirts and hats or whatever. You know, there's 10 different producers. And well, let's elevate that. Let's make it 10 producers who are, or 20 producers who can sustain life. Now you've got a guy who can, a grease recycler who can make biodiesel. You have another guy that can make conversions and turn cars into, that they can accept diesels and he can make them so that they can process it. So we have all of the necessities. We have a solar guy. You know, think of all your utilities. You have a contractor can build a house, a guy that does solar, all of our utilities. So you have somebody that can run and does a cable system so that we can have internet, all of the things that we pay for utilities. So now we have a completely independent system that's barter-based. Now we need a currency so that we can innovate it, because barter itself is kind of slow. Well, what if we just issue $1,000 without debt? They all have a credit of $1,000. Now each one of them can trade their currency. There's no debt in that system. Just like in the beginning of a Monopoly board game, everybody starts with $1,500. You know, we could start off with $100,000 if we wanted. It doesn't really matter that much what the number is. So from there, we just trade our hours with one another. We have no debt. That money circulates. And based upon those 20 different producers, other providers can come in. They, you know, let's say they don't have life necessities where they make like a hat. You don't need a hat as a life necessity, but they join that system. And when those providers come in, they get a certain amount of currency as well, and they don't have any debt. We all just circulate our currency within one another. But meanwhile, whoever is the most productive will still earn the most currency. So we haven't eliminated the free market. All we've done is eliminated the money monopoly over that free market.
Based on your personal experience, what are some of the challenges in getting people on board with this idea generally? And what are some of the legal issues associated with instituting a local currency?
I'll do the legal first. And basically, it's kind of backward because on one hand, they want us to pay tax on these currency transactions as if they were Federal Reserve notes. So that's where you have a difficulty because you have to pay all the local taxes and all the income taxes, et cetera, even if it was just barter and there's no currency, you would still have to pay the tax in Federal Reserve notes. And the problem is right now people don't have enough Federal Reserve notes. So that's the limiting factor. On one hand, they require, they think your currency is legitimate and they require you to pay taxes on it. But on the other hand, they won't let you pay your taxes with that currency. So that is going to be my challenge to them is like, how can you on one hand say that these are taxable transactions and that they're valid for tax, but on the other hand, not accept our currency for tax payments? And that is going to be the way that I'm really going to push them is because they have cognitive dissonance. They're trying to have the best of both worlds kind of thing. And, just to expand that same thought, the Bristol pound in England is a local currency where the mayor accepts 100% of his pay in the local currency, and they can pay their taxes with the local currency. So since they can do it, we can, but we haven't done it yet. These are all our hurdles that we're going to have to jump as we move forward. So those are the legal issues. You have to pay the taxes as it is. And with respect to it being legal or any of that kind of stuff, all this is a common community coupon. In order to make this illegal, you'd have to make coupons, gift certificates, vouchers, et cetera, illegal. And by the way, one of the biggest things that, you know, the commodity money people, they're always worried about the technology of paper money. In the meanwhile, what I like to say to refute that objection is that this won't work. As I say to them, is the reason why paper money and digital money didn't work is it's issued by non-producers, meaning non-producer banks. What value do bankers produce in order to issue currency? Whereas a restaurant, when they issue currency in the form of a gift certificate, it's backed by a meal, right? But what value in the same way is the banker issuing money? What is the value they're delivering to the community? What's the life necessity? It's not there. So banks and corporations are parasitic, and they're issuing currency. When they issue currency, they're issuing as non-producers. And that's why paper and digital money doesn't work when they issue it. Whereas when producers issue currency, paper currency or digital currency, in the form of vouchers, coupons, gift certificates, tickets for games, sporting events, concerts, paper and digital money work perfectly fine when producers issue those currencies. So that completely gets us out of that whole dependence upon monopoly gold and silver. That takes you down a wrong path, and it never works because, you know, the common man doesn't own a gold mine, but the have-nots, a regular person in our community, can issue a gift certificate, therefore they can issue mountain hours or hour money. Yesterday, I was just speaking to an individual. I have like a marketing system that goes out and recruits after they sign up to my email list, so it educates people about the process, and this is somebody right in my community. I sell different things. I sell products where I teach communities how to set these system up, and I have the system itself in my community where, for instance, a restaurant owner replied to one of my automated email series, which trains them to why they want to join the system. anyway, that their questions were like, well, how do I do the taxes? How do, you know, if somebody comes in and buys a meal for in this instance, the meal was like $32.50. So how would you pay for that with hours? Well, I said, well, that's 3.5 hours. We don't have any coins. So probably what you would do is, you know, round that up or down. What typically you do it in favor of your customer. So that what means in this system, 1 hour is $10. So we have denominations in four different amounts equivalent to a $1, $5, $10, and $20 denomination. So the 1 hour is 10 bucks, 2 hours is 20, a half hour is 5, and 1/10 of an hour is the $1 bill. So in this transaction for 3.5 hours, and the bill was 32 bucks. So you would give them 3/10 of an hour in change in the local currency. So that's how that would work. And then they go, well, how would you pay for the tip? You know, that gets tricky because, you know, maybe, you know, the business is willing to accept it, but you have an employee who's not willing to accept it. So if you're, depends on your policy, if you started all your employees and say, hey, we don't want to support a global war on terror where the global bankers are warring on the people globally, we don't want to support that because it's not in alignment with my consciousness. I don't want to support all of these policies that are financed through the money system. So you might have a highly conscious workforce where they want to get paid in their base salary and their tips. So it really depends upon the culture of the business, how the tips and the employee pay works. So those are kind of a couple of the common questions. But the basis of the idea is whatever everybody right now is pissed off about something of the system. Just name one issue off the top of your head, and I can tell you how a local currency system is the only thing that will fix that issue on a fundamental level. So let's say, for instance, it's Monsanto, right? That's a common thing. And, you know, we're so self-limiting in our beliefs. If somebody says, well, you know, I want to have an organic restaurant. Like, well, you know, that's really good. And like, well, I hate Monsanto. If somebody says, I hate Monsanto, the only way to fundamentally fix the issue of Monsanto is to have a local currency. And the reason that is let's say we win the right to label Monsanto for GMO foods as being poison. Well, just because you know it's poison, well, we know that the water is fluoridated. We know our water is fluoridated, but we're still consuming it in many instances. I would say the majority of people in communities that have fluoridated water, they're aware of it, but they're still consuming it, right? So we need a bigger solution. We have to eliminate that poison food from our system, and better yet, we need to be able to, number one, afford organic food, which is about a third more expensive, and it takes more time to prepare. So once people make more money, which they will, like just for instance, in our money system, the minimum wage in the bank money is, I don't know, it's like $7.50 an hour. In our system, it's $10 an hour. So this allows people to afford organic food. And because they make more money, they have more time so that they can prepare organic food. So at a fundamental level, this is the solution to whatever the particular war, the police state, whatever the particular issue is, monetary reform is the foundational solution to that problem.
So you've alluded to this a little bit in what you just said, but can you explain a bit more how Mountain Hours embodies this idea of a non-aggression principle? And going off of that, how can Mountain Hours help us transcend this right-left paradigm that often keeps people divided?
I love this stuff. That's my favorite question right there. Because I say to, because that's where I'm a voluntarist, but I'm not a supporter of commodity money because it's scarce. And if you think about this from a, you know, just from a motivational standpoint, if everything as human beings or all life seeks pleasure and avoids pain, right? So it's the carrot and stick thing. In our society, I represent the government as the stick, and the banker's control over the money is the carrot. Even if we eliminate government and have a so-called free market, you still have the bankers who have monopoly control over the stick, or sorry, the carrot of rewards, right? Doesn't that make sense? It's plain to me. And what I like to explain, like from the Bible, mammon or the money power existed long before governments came around. The money power was able to control society without force just by controlling the reward system. So if you have scarce rewards like gold and silver and Bitcoin, if you have a very scarce reward system, whoever controls the gold, silver, and Bitcoin mines, they're going to control that economy. They're going to control that society. So let's say we dissolved government tomorrow. Whoever controls the money system, we would still have to go work for the bankers in order to earn Federal Reserve notes, gold, or silver, because we'd still, the bankers own all the land and the commodities and the utilities, and they own everything. So we would still, even though the government wouldn't force us, we wouldn't have any taxes, but we would still have to pay our mortgage, or we're going to be homeless, right? I would still have to go get a job that pays in gold, silver, Bitcoin, or Federal Reserve notes in order to pay my mortgage. I would still have to earn those scarce monopoly money forms in order to pay for my utility bill. I would still have to, my car loan, all of those. So you still have this monopoly over money, even though you eliminated government. So what we need to do, that, you know, the next step is we want to have a revolution, and we don't want, they're engineering conflict between, you know, the police and military debt slaves, the police and military in uniform debt slaves. You know, we're all debt slaves. There's the bankers who are the creditors. There's creditors and debtors. We are all debtors. They're the creditors because they own all of the real assets, the physical commodities, et cetera, et cetera. Well, the way they stay in power in a tiny percentage is they engineer conflict between the debt slaves in and out of uniform, and they're engineering this conflict right now. And rather than having that conflict, let's just forgive each other's debts, the bankers' debts, you know, those who are in uniform, say, hey, just use our currency, use our money, we'll pay you what you're making right now because we have abundant money. We have to be able to reward those who are in uniform, the enforcers, judges, politicians, if we even want them, but the enforcers for sure. But when we get the military and police to join our side with our abundant money, they'll join our side because they can simultaneously feed and clothe their family and have a house, so we can provide that to them in this monetary system that's completely sovereign. Meanwhile, we have the added benefit where they can join us and keep their souls, right? Because right now they're selling their souls for their scarce money and working for the bankers. They're doing it right now, and they're not able to uphold their oaths. Even if they want to, they can't, because, you know, eventually the bankers will just stop paying the good people who are trying to, you know, protect the people instead of the bankers. So the basis of the voluntary society is, if you're going to get people to volunteer to do something, you have to motivate them with rewards. If it's a voluntary society, we can't force people to do anything. So it's either the carrot or the stick. So we need abundant rewards. So you need abundant money. And our money is abundant, whereas scarce gold, silver, and Bitcoin, and even Federal Reserve notes are scarce as well, despite all the bank propaganda that we have lots of money when we don't. I wanted to add the left-right paradigm, and there's one aspect to that that's essential in what we're discussing here. So anyway, with respect to healing the divide which has been engineered between the left and the right, the right supports the non-aggression principle. So it's really kind of easy to give the right or libertarians what they want. Just stop stealing from us. Don't force us to do anything. And that's, you know, from the Bible, it's thou shalt not steal. That means governments, corporations, nobody can steal. So with this monetary solution, we can achieve that. We can support the non-aggression principle. No other currency system can do this, because we can finance social programs by birthing brand new money to pay for social, civil, environmental, educational, and retirement programs without violating the non-aggression principle. We can birth brand new money, and this is gonna thing that's gonna heal the divide between the right and the left. And I have people who have come here to Summit County, like Bill Still, Adam Kokesh, Sheriff Richard Mack, Gary Franchi, Jordan Page. Those are leaders, thought leaders from the libertarian movement, have all come here and spent voluntary mountain hours. They've earned them and spent them. Meanwhile, from the left, we had vice presidential nominee of the Green Party, Sherry Honkola, come here. And most of the members, by the way, in this community, most of the members are Greens. So she came here and tested it. So all we have to do to get the allegiance of the Greens is, it's not that they love taxes. They just want to make sure that they have a social, that we provide a social safety net. And we have to do that as a one love. You know, my religion is one love. We are all one. And that means that freedom just doesn't mean that we can do whatever we want and have a survival of the fittest thing. That's kind of the libertarian, that's where it kind of goes, right? Because they just, you know, they're just kind of, it's going to work out. Well, the way to really evolve that and give peace of mind, that's what we want for everybody. We're going to offer peace of mind to the right by offering the non-aggression principle as a foundational requirement. Additionally, we'll offer peace of mind to the left and require of ourselves that we're going to support all of these various programs, which we all need. We at different points in our life, we're going to need these things. It's just a matter of time till we get sick or retire or need education or any of these things. So as long as we remove the force and we're able to supply these things, and you know, the next thing that comes up is people, well, you're just going to create inflation. Well, no, we won't. An hour is an hour is an hour. We can always maintain the value of our currency, and that's what's unique. Because if a dollar, if our currency was a dollar, well, how much is a dollar? You know, or how much is an ounce of gold fluctuates in value? An ounce of silver fluctuates in value. A Bitcoin fluctuates in value. Whereas an hour is an hour is an hour. It's always 60 minutes. And because of that, at the very core of the system, we can make sure that that unit always remains the same. And when every community, the entire system, the basis of the integrity of their system is based upon that same thing, that hour can be exchanged among all those various systems, and that brings that responsibility back to the community itself. That's the most important thing that each community will do, is make sure that they deliver sufficient value for their hours. The exact same way that a restaurant owner delivers value for his gift certificate, in order to, for that restaurant owner to have integrity, he's got to deliver that value of that meal. We have to do that same thing on a community, county-wide basis. And in doing so, that commitment that we are going to, it's basically three commitments, is the non-aggression principle, that our hours, that we're going to deliver value for the paper that we issue, and that we're going to make sure that we retain our humanity. It's the one love means that we respect ourselves, we respect our family itself, but the whole world is our family. You know, that's what compassion really means. Injustice anywhere is injustice everywhere. So we have to prove these things to ourselves, that in order to govern and be self-governing in a voluntary society, we got to prove that we can self-govern. And in order to do that, we have to make sure that we offer peace of mind to everyone. That's how we do it. It's these three core commitments, is that the non-aggression principle, that we're going to deliver one love, compassion to our tribe, and that we're going to deliver this 1 hour per hour value to our paper that we issue locally.
Can you quickly provide some concrete examples of how you're making use of Mountain Hour script in Summit County to build local resilience and self-sufficiency through building up healthcare programs, affordable housing, jobs, so on and so forth?
Right off the top of my head, for instance, there's a local business that recycles grease, and it's Summit Grease Recycling. and they go around the Rockies collecting grease and then converting that to biodiesel. We did a transaction where they signed up for Mountain Hours. They issued currency, and they now accept that biodiesel, which is entirely created in our community. So now we have locally birthed hours, community currency, and locally birthed grease. So that is diametrically opposite of the global petrodollar. The greatest thing that enslaves humanity right now is the petrodollar. When a country like Iraq decides that they're going to stop trading in the petrodollar, they get invaded, right? So it's the biggest source for war. And effectively, when Iraq is using petrodollars, they're actually financing the U.S. military in order to invade them. They're financing their own enslavement. So it's this paradox where you're simultaneously financing your own enslavement, just like it does for us individually. Well, with this local system where we created an independent biodiesel hour-based energy system, we can have cars that use the local currency and use the locally provided biodiesel to be completely independent of the petrodollar.
Could you help us understand the Jubilee Share system? Specifically, how is it different from Mountain Hour's script? How does it complement that script? And how can it further facilitate cooperation and foster a sense of brotherhood amongst people?
Okay. Well, basically, I'd like to refer to the Bible. And Jesus' one violent act, he goes, "You've turned my father's house, my father's temple, into a den of thieves." Well, his father's temple is planet Earth, and the den of thieves is the bankers or mammon or the money lenders or, you know, whatever you want to call the bank cabal, the money monopoly. So planet Earth is a bank colony. The United States is a bank colony, a corporation. And they've set that up so that these people, this tiny group of men, rule humanity, and they've set up where, you know, they offer benefits to people that serve their agenda, and they offer themselves. They live in abundance, and we live in scarcity, even though we're the ones that produce all the value, and we're the ones that go to fight the wars and die and sweat and bleed. So to fix that, I like the idea of what Bitcoin has done with respect to the idea where it's put this idea that there's something that we can implement without getting permission from the powers that be. I like that idea. The problem is the same people that control all the gold, silver, and Federal Reserve notes are also the people that have all the big computers, so they're the ones that can control the issuance of the Bitcoin. And Bitcoin went from zero to $1,200, and it actually surpassed the price of gold, even though it's based upon really nothing. You know, when it went from zero to $1,200, there's no lives that were saved. There was nobody that was healed. There was no, you know, there's no true and genuine benefit to the human experience, mind, body, soul, right? Well, that's what we want. Well, that, you know, everybody can agree. We want to have peace of mind for all humanity. That's the goal. We want to have compassion and justice and peace. Well, as I was saying before, if we get people to agree with a new social contract, to get that buzz where people want to participate in this new contract, in Mountain Hours, the currency never fluctuates in value. So you're never going to have that spike where Bitcoin went from zero to $1,200, or you can speculate on gold and silver. There's no speculation. Whereas in Jubilee Shares, that we're going to start this, is when people agree to participate in this revolution, we're going to issue a Jubilee Share to every human being on the planet, because God doesn't make any mistakes. That's number one. No matter what, you get a share of planet Earth. You are valuable. Then you get an additional share for agreeing to the non-aggression principle, and then you get another share in agreeing to the commitment to the one love, that we're going to supply a portion of our energy toward the social, civil, and environmental programs in order to pay for a planet that can sustain us, right? So those three commitments are going to, you get one Jubilee share no matter what. You get another for the non-aggression principle, another for the commitment to the one love of compassion, And then you can earn additional shares as you participate. Like, for instance, you just covering this topic will set up, you know, I haven't set up all the details, but the philosophical idea is the more that we promote this, let's say that there's five people in your community that dedicate to setting this up, not with the intention of setting up a local currency, but they commit that they're going to create a self-sufficient local currency, as I stated before, with those 20 businesses where you have energy and all the utilities, et cetera, that once they establish that, that each one of them, let's say that we gave each one of them 10 Jubilee shares for their commitment of time and intention to establish that, not with the intention, but after they established it. So you're rewarding outcomes rather than good intentions. The government likes to talk about good intentions. We're going to reward outcomes. So just think of what the value of these Jubilee shares will happen in terms of a speculative thing. Really what it is, it's humanity's bet that it can create a better planet than the bankers. The more that we buy into that idea that, and by the way, all of this land is ours, and the Jubilee from the Bible has four essential aspects. One is the forgiveness of all debt. Two is the return of all the land to its original owners. Three is the release of nonviolent prisoners. And four is the rest and restoration of the land. So we heal the planet, get the plant, everybody that's in prison for nonviolent crimes, which is far too many. The land is the people's land. It was stolen from the natives, and we're all the natives. The bankers own it now. It needs to be returned. And all of our debts, it's unpayable because the money was the money system's based on usury. The debts were unpayable, and any contract based on fraud is vitiated. Fraud vitiates all contract. So all of these things are built into this revolution. And whether you're a believer or a non-believer, it doesn't matter. Everybody benefits from this and will develop so much more buzz as these Jubilee shares, and it'll allow people to, there's some things that we can buy with our local money system in the local currency, but, you know, let's say, you know, you want to travel cross country and you're going to need some Federal Reserve notes. So that will allow activists to earn these shares, which they can convert over to Federal Reserve notes or whatever, so that they're able to live in abundance, so that they can travel and, you know, that they can have an abundant life as we go through this revolution, so that we're not having to live off-grid in scarcity, and it'll provide a methodology where we can have some abundance.
Now, you've already mentioned Ithaca Hours and Paul Glover's work there. You also alluded to local script in Argentina during the 2000 crisis. Are there other local currency systems in place in the United States, and how successful are they? Are you in cooperation with them in any way?
My fiance Robin and I actually established five of them. One's Clearwater Hours in Tampa. That's where we're from. In Denver, we set up Mile High Hours because we need to get food here. We're at 10,000 feet here in Breckenridge. And then in Long Island is Island Hours. And then Tennessee, we did Volunteer Hours. So we wanted to show people that these are really simple to set up. It's just paper, you know, it's barter script. And we set up all of those in a year. So it's really, we set up a system where we train communities how to set this up and how to do it quickly, effectively, and with integrity, and how to market it, and then how to pitch it to businesses, because you have to go out and pitch this to business owners. So anyway, those are the five that we started. Ithaca Hours has been around for 20 years, so this is a proven model. As I said before, there are 3,000 of these local community currencies during the Great Depression when money was scarce at that time. Madison has Madison Hours. There's River Hours up in the Columbia Gorge region. There's Lakes Hours that we started with a guy in Minnesota. Aloha Hours in Hawaii. We like to work with other hours-based denominations because that guarantees, like for instance, there's Berkshires in Massachusetts. How much is a Berkshire worth? They tie it to like a one for one for a dollar, but a dollar is up and down all over the place. So that's what's unique about an hour. So we always like to, you know, whenever you're designing something, you want to start with the end in mind. And an hour is the optimal unit value of money because you can create it fixed in value. Whereas a share, What's a share? You know what I mean? An hour is something that is fixed by the cosmos. The creator created an hour.
Now, do you think it's possible to fit our current economic and ecological predicaments into a larger historical context? And if so, how can understanding our place in history help guide us through these tough times?
I can go in and pitch this to people on the left and the right. Sometimes it's actually easier to pitch it to people on the left, even though I came from a libertarian background, because they're not so stuck on the gold, silver, commodity money thing. And I live in Breckenridge, and this is heaven on earth here. It's absolutely magnificently beautiful. And my therapy is to go run up this mountain behind me. And it's the most healing thing that there is after working on the computer. It just sets my mind right. And we need to respect what the creator has given us. Like, it's just divinely amazing what we have, that we live the life, that we have our senses in this beautiful planet. And getting from a historical standpoint, getting back to the Jubilee, when I started this political awakening, I wasn't religious at all. I just focused on truth and the correct monetary reform system. And it's strange how there's so many lies and violence in the Bible that I was just so turned off by religion that I never investigated that. But then when I started studying usury just means money monopoly and unpayable contracts that are born of interest. It's the math proves that usury is wrong, right? The math does. Even if you're a non-believer, you can look at the math and it's impossible to pay exponentially growing debt. There's nothing in nature that grows exponentially without dying. You know, there's no 1,000-foot trees. So it's completely unnatural to have this debt that we keep throwing all of our human and natural resources against, expecting that this is going to work out well. That's what austerity is born, because we keep committing our life's energy and the planet itself into paying this unpayable black hole of debt. That's why the planet is being destroyed. So I was looking at this, and all of a sudden I bumped my head against this idea of Jubilee. The Jubilee idea has been around prior to the Bible. The Jews and Christians borrowed that from previous culture. This is just ancient sacred economics. And we just keep rejecting these ideas. This is something that's 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 years old, when it's just so obvious we need to have a Jubilee. It's so obvious. But because we're trying to be wise, you know, these smart intellectuals, instead of just accepting and surrendering to the wisdom of our ancient ancestors, right within the Jubilee, it says rest and restoration of the land. Well, isn't that what the planet needs right now, is rest and restoration? Don't we need to forgive debts? Don't we need to return the land to the original, to us? So that here in Summit County, you have these globalist veil resorts that run the town, because they're financed by the money power. So they take these beautiful little Victorian towns and they end up controlling it, where we have some members of Mountain Hours, and this just breaks my heart and pisses me off, man. You have members that have restaurants that they've worked in for 20 years. They have no chance of a retirement. They can't buy their building because the property is so expensive. Meanwhile, you have these globalist powers where they own all of this real estate in our community, and they don't even live here. So that's what I want to do with the Jubilees. I want those people that have owned their businesses for 20 years, worked hard to provide for their families, I want them to have that real estate so that they have peace of mind, not so some elite people can own 30 houses and just this disproportionate share of the wealth. So that's the all-encompassing divine idea of the Jubilee.
In wrapping up a little bit, are there any specific events or projects that you're launching in the near future you'd like people to know about? And can people across the country who want to get involved with this initiative get a hold of you and get a hold of some training material to help them do that?
Okay, well, with respect to getting information, like this revolution, you know, in order... Everything that everybody's mad about is based upon usurpation. if you're what irrespective of whatever it is, it's usurpation. So in order to fix that usurpation, we need to have a non-usury based money system. This revolution is a participation based activity. We have to take action. We can't be helpless children protesting, voting, complaining, petitioning, posting on the internet alone. We have to get involved. And it's really, I can't express enough how much fun it is to go. When people sign up for Mountain Hours, half the time they give me a hug because they feel empowered. All the things that they're angry about, when their votes feel less and less valuable, when they sign the currency into existence, they smile, we take a picture of them, we put them on our Facebook page. It's fun. Like it makes them feel like they're a part of something, both the person as the activist and the business when they join. So it's beautiful. We call it a love currency. So those that are listening, please go to start.ourmoney. It's ourmoney.net. And that's how you can learn how to start this system in your community. And don't worry about the money. Like you know, whatever skills you lack, you can put ads on Craigslist and you'll get more people to join. You can start a meetup group. And all it is a local barter system. It's easy to set up. It's really easy. From there, if you go to that website, start.ourmoney.net, there's a link in there that says love revolution, because we have a love currency. We're going to have a love revolution. We're not blaming anybody. We're just choosing not to participate with this evil system anymore. And in the love revolution link, it talks about Jubilee shares. It talks about the details of how we're going to get a group of individuals from the left who are going to participate, like Paul Glover. And we're going to have, like Bob Marley had, a One Love concert where we commit to this path. The left and the right are going to join because we're committing this path. We're going to support the non-aggression principle. We're going to finance social programs without violating the NAP. That gets people, it respects the values of both those on the left and the right. Respect is love. One love is victory. This is the revolution. Like I can't explain it any better than this, because it's based upon foundational beliefs throughout the human experience. Our ancient ancestors suffered from this exact same problem. They didn't have all the technology, but they suffered from the same problem. History repeats. We can learn from their, we can learn from them, use their solution, Jubilee, let it be, and that's how we save the world.
So I'll be sure to provide links to all your content so people can get a hold of that if they so wish. And again, I'd like to thank you again for making some time for me today. This has been a really nice conversation.
Well, hold on, John. I want this as part of the interview. John, are you a love revolutionary?
I believe I am.
Well, get on board, baby. Get involved. This is a contact sport. I understand you're in Rochester?
I'm actually in North Carolina.
North Carolina? Okay. Well, just as a starting process, right? Whatever's in your community, and I'm saying this so listeners can think about it, the currency itself becomes like a chamber of commerce thing. So whatever's in your town that's unique and fun, and why do you want to invite people to come there, right? So in our community, like we put snowboarding, mountain biking, and these images will all went on the currency. And it's Mountain Hours, so people come to the Mountain Hours because mountains give you a certain kind of experience of the human experience. It's different, you know? So I don't know if you're in the mountainous part, but think of these kind of things. What would be the name of the currency? What would you put on the currency? So, you know, our beliefs, our thoughts become our reality. So if we think and we focus on our emancipation, we achieve emancipation. And that's what we have to do. We have to start really focusing on this, and that's how it happens.
Is there anything else you'd like to leave us with?
No, that is it. One love. I appreciate you taking the time to cover this essential topic, like I said. And let's get excited. The path is there for us to achieve victory. All we have to do is walk the path, and victory is now. That once we have the right idea, all we have to do is walk the path and win.
All right. Thank you very much, Wayne, for your time. I really, really appreciate it.
All right. Thank you, John.